How my joy through the ages to see of His love for me. Everybody sing it.
Hi, I'm Brian Hale, and I'm so glad that you've joined us for today's message. If you have your Bible, I would ask that you would turn to Romans chapter 1, verse 17, and we're going to preach on just this one specific verse. And very seldom I will preach on one verse. Rather, I would share on a passage of several verses or paragraphs of Scripture. However, today, this one particular verse is so powerful that we could spend countless hours discussing the power behind the words found in Romans chapter 1, verse 17. Here the word says, "For in the gospel the righteousness of God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith." Now, we've said the word faith a couple of times. Now I want to talk about another word, and that is the word gullible. Now, it never ceases to amaze me just how gullible people are. When P.T. Barnum said that there's a sucker born every minute, he wasn't kidding. He was right. And it seems there's no limit as to what we believe. Listen to some of the titles that have appeared in the tabloids found in the grocery stores at checkout lines. Cow mattresses help cows produce more milk. Mom on a diet of only chicken lays a huge egg. World War II bomber found on the moon. Woman gives birth to a 2-year-old baby. Child walks and talks in 3 days. Adam and Eve's bones found in Asia. Eve was a space alien. Now, the sad thing is that many people believe this nonsense. Being gullible is certainly a word that can be used to describe many people. But gullible is also a word that has been used to describe Christians. Some people who consider themselves to be logical or rational believe that Christians are gullible for their faith in God. We believe in miracles and in an unseen God, and to them, that is evidence of our being gullible. My friend, there's nothing gullible about believing in the Lord. The Bible teaches that faith is the key for everything for the Christian. By faith, we come to Christ. By faith, we live our Christian lives with joy and gladness. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. That's found in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. Faith is the core of our Christian living. Faith is the key to unlock the door to certainty and eternity. A famous Baptist evangelist once told the story of an elderly lady who was very upset by all of her real and imaginary troubles. Out of frustration, her family told her, "Grandma, we've done all that we can do, and now all we can do is just trust God for the rest." A look of despair spread over her face as she replied, "Oh dear, has it come to that?" Church, it has always come to that, so we might as well begin with that. So let's begin with faith and see just what the Scripture has to say as it relates to our salvation and how we live our lives. Righteousness revealed. For in the gospel, a righteousness from God is revealed. The Apostle Paul made the point that God works in a powerful way with the Word of God. So here we have righteousness revealed to us. In a lot of passages, Paul points out the truth that everyone who believes in the message of the gospel is saved from their sins. This shows us that Jesus Christ is the center point of our faith. When Paul writes that in the gospel, a righteousness from God is revealed, he is really speaking of the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus Christ is the message of the gospel. The gospel centers in the person of Jesus Christ. It's all about his sinless life, the atonement for our sins, and the supernatural resurrection. He is the center of the gospel, so he is the center of our faith. God's righteousness is revealed to us in two very obvious ways. First, Christ is righteousness. There is none other. And secondly, Christ imparts his righteousness to us. We have been cleansed from our sins. This is the function and purpose of preaching the gospel. This is why Paul emphasizes Christ and him crucified in preaching of the gospel. This is why we celebrate the Lord's table together, to remember the righteous one who was crucified in our place. This truth is the basis for our salvation. And we can only be saved because of what God has done. The Bible teaches that we are all sinners for two reasons. Number one, we are born into sin. And number two, by choice, we ignore or we deny or reject God's plan for salvation. The fact is, we are totally unable to save ourselves. The good news is this, is that salvation has been made possible for us through God's Son, Jesus Christ. We must first understand the message of the gospel so we will know how we can be saved, and thus giving us faith for living, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith. So the way that the righteousness of God is given to us is only through faith. You see, that's why it's called good news. And if we all understand that Christ is righteous and we are not, well, that is not good news. The bad news is when we don't trust or we don't have the faith in this truth. The righteousness of God is offered to us only if we exercise our faith to receive it. In fact, we are told that this righteousness comes to us by faith from first to last. Faith is, number one, how we receive the righteousness of Christ, and number two, how we walk in that righteousness. Many of us have had faith to receive his righteousness. Aren't you blessed of God for that? But what is true biblical faith after we have received his righteousness? Is faith something we do? No. On the contrary, true biblical faith is never a work we perform because we are somehow good and worthy. No. True biblical faith means rejecting all of our works and trusting completely in Christ for everything. I know what you're thinking, Pastor, how am I going to remember all of this? Well, there's an easy way to explain this. And here it is. Forsaking all, I trust him. Forsaking all, I trust him. True biblical faith is casting oneself wholly on the Lord Jesus Christ for your only hope for salvation. Faith is trusting in what Jesus did on the cross, and that is all you need. There was once a man named John Patton who was translating the Bible in a South Seas Island tribe. And John Patton was discovering that the natives had no word for trust or faith as he was trying to work on this. And one day a native who had been working hard outside came into the missionary's house and he flopped down into a large comfortable chair and said, "It's good to rest my whole weight on this chair." And this became kind of a revelation to Patton. He said, "That's it. I'll translate faith as resting one's whole weight on God." When we believe in God the way the Bible tells us to, we are indeed resting our whole weight on him. It is by faith that we have the righteousness of Christ imputed or imparted to us. It is also by faith that we live out our everyday life. See, we must not only trust Christ for our salvation, but we must also trust Christ for our very lives. In our text, Paul quotes from the Old Testament prophet Habakkuk when he says, "The righteous," or the just, "will live by faith." That's Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4. We also find this quotation here in Galatians chapter 3, 11, and Hebrews 10:38. It is one of the greatest statements of all Scripture. Faith is the only way we can live. Recently, there's been a lot of interest on television with survival stories, great survival stories, and people have become very fascinated with the situation of survival. And would it not be a wonderful thing if we Christians would become fascinated with spiritual survival? If that were the case, the only thing we would need would be faith in Christ and Christ alone. Our scripture text for today was used by God to change the life of Martin Luther and bring a spiritual revolution to Christianity. Martin Luther, he was a devout monk living in Rome, Italy, and he, like a lot of Christians, had been trying to earn his salvation by doing good works for God. And any one of us can relate to that story, in that Martin Luther became very frustrated. He wrote these words to himself, "But what works? What works can come from a heart like mine? How I stand before the holiness of my judge with my works polluted in their very source." Now, these words can seem a little strange and ancient to us, but simply put, it goes like this. Martin Luther was having a very hard time being a Christian and was very discouraged with his relationship with God. So Martin Luther began to study the book of Romans, and he came across this passage of Scripture, "The righteous will live by faith." And it began to speak to his heart. On another day, Martin Luther was in the church where there was a set of medieval stone stairs, which supposedly were the stairs leading up to Pilate's house in Jerusalem. Apparently, these were supposed to be the same stairs that Jesus walked upon. They're called the Scalia Sancta, or the Holy Stairs. Many pilgrims to Rome would ascend these steps on their knees, pausing to pray at various intervals where the stains were said to have come from the bleeding wounds of Christ. It was there that God brought the words of Scripture to Martin Luther's mind. "The just shall live by faith." Luther saw clearly his superstition and shuddered at it. He realized that he could never save himself by his works or his rituals, but he could be saved by the righteousness of Christ, received by faith. So he descended those stairs a new man. And of course, he became the man that God used for the greatest reformation that the church has ever known. In fact, it is known historically as the Great Reformation of the 16th century. But notice that the scripture does not simply say that the righteous will be saved by faith. It declares that the righteous will live by faith. Faith is not just something to which we enter into a right relationship with God. Faith is also what we live with every single day. It is not that we come to Christ by faith and then we live by good works. Remember, it is from faith to faith. That's what the word says. By faith, from first to faith. In other words, it is from faith to faith to faith to faith and so on. Faith becomes not just a one-time incident that happens at an altar or when a pastor preaches a dynamic message. No, no, no. Faith becomes a way of life. Faith is the principle of life for the believer. The Bible calls all of us to trust in Christ. We are to believe in Christ. So do you believe? I mean, do you truly trust Christ? Have you experienced that in the Spirit, that Christ is your Savior? Does your heart call out to Him like a childlike trust? If you do not know Jesus, cast yourself on Him as your only hope of salvation. And if you've trusted Christ and you have been touched by the power of His Holy Spirit, then it is time to set aside your own strength for living and trust him daily. Christ is all you need. We have something that God's people did not have, it say in Exodus chapter 19, and that is God's Holy Spirit to help us. Our faith in Christ should naturally produce a godly result. Missionary David Brainerd, he talks about how this was proven in the mission field that God had sent him to. He said, "I never got away from the teaching of Jesus and him crucified. When my people were gripped by this great evangelical doctrine of Christ and him crucified, I had no need to give them instructions about morality." In another place he wrote, "I find my Indians have begun to put on the garments of holiness, and their common life begins to be sanctified even in the small matters where they are possessed by the doctrine of Christ and him crucified." So maybe, just maybe, it's time for us to put on the garment of holiness and live out our lives in the doctrine of Christ and him crucified. Let me pray for you. Father in heaven, I believe that so often we can get things so muddy that the actual simple truths get lost. But the fact of the matter is, Lord, if we can live a life where we just live out daily the doctrine of you, Jesus, that you were crucified for us in our place, that you were our supreme sacrifice, you are our high priest, and you were our sacrifice for the redemption, the cleansing of our sins, that they are completely wiped away when we place our faith and trust and hope in you. As we do that today, Lord, as we put our complete faith in you and not you and our works or you and some doctrine or you and this and that practice and this discipline. No, Lord, it is you alone that we cast our hope upon, and you never disappoint. Thank you for the good God that you are, Lord. Help us to continue during these days to walk in faith. The faith that you have overcome the world, you have overcome sin and death, and that we indeed are a child of the King. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you, and we will see you next week. That brings us to the end of today's broadcast. I'm so glad that you joined us. If you're ever in our area, we would love to have you and your family come and visit us here at New Horizons Community Church. We're located at 31 East Madison Road in Skowhegan, and our telephone number is 207-474-2957, and you can find us on the web at www.nhccskowhegan.org. Well, God bless you, and we'll see you next time for A Better Life.